like that one. I think it was in the middle of the track list from the Dropbox file at least.
Yeah, sorry about that, man.
No, it's all good. I just remember I was listening to the songs, and it wasn't like until like maybe like recently that I like had the revelation. I'm like, oh yeah, he sent me the track list, like the One Piece with with the art and everything. I was like, oh, that's right, I can just look at them, because I didn't know what the names were, I was just like guessing off the file, you know what I'm saying?
That video is kind of cool, which I guess has already aired by this point, because Joystick, when they tour, I feel like the core is always Duck, Clay, and Mickey, and then the rest is like who's available at that time. So it could be Dante or Kyle on drums. The horn section can kind of be mixed around, but this video has everybody in it. So you got Dante and Kyle, both our drummers. You got all four horn players, and it's a really cool concept Duck came up with.
Yeah, hell yeah, dude. I was gonna say, like, that, like, kind of like to go off what you're saying, that, everyone's in the video. That's one thing I noticed, like, through your guys' photos and stuff. It seems like there's like a huge team to the band almost. How much people, like, in total, you would say?
We have eight in the band and then nine if you count Dante, but Dante and Kyle will switch out when they play on drums.
Okay. Yeah.
I think they sit down during the same show. Like they'll do that.
Yeah.
Really? Oh shit. Hey, that's pretty dope. I mean, has everyone just kind of like, been playing for the steady in the same lineup for a while, that everyone's just kind of on board with how the band, like, keeps moving?
Yeah.
So it's kind of a good benefit to having four horn players, because I think it's rarely all four at a show, but it ensures that we can play whatever tour or whatever show pops up, and then the horn players that are available show up. So there might be a tour where it's a trumpet and a trombone, or it might be two trombones and a sax, or
Yeah.
but yeah, it's kind of cool and gives Joystick the freedom to play whenever. I have toured before, but I have had a lot of like job stuff, like sort of keep me at home, where I've done local shows.
Yeah.
I have done different like 7 to 10 day runs, but now thanks to COVID, I have like a month of vacation time booked. So next time touring's possible, I'm up for whatever.
Yeah, no, that's tight, because earlier when we started the interview, it was like being broken down that there was like two drummers that come in and switch out. I think that's tight, especially in like ska. Sometimes bands have a hard time like communicating and staying together, and it seems like everyone's kind of like tapped in, and everyone's on board with like the new record that's coming out. And I just think that's, honestly, as a musician, I just think that's sick to see,
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
I think we've just been around each other so long. I mean, we all kind of like know how to communicate without like saying it, maybe. Does that make sense? We all kind of like have similar, we think a lot alike, when it comes to this kind of stuff. I feel like in like the last 4 or 5 years, we have like, once we kind of started like, like, hey, maybe we should like put a little effort into this. It's around maybe like around the time I got sober about 4 years ago, and so like that's kind of when we were like, hey, like what if we like took it a little more serious and like let's see what happens. And that's like around the time that Stomp released the last album and we started touring more and like yeah, so it's
Buck's
cool.
amazing at churning out these ideas too, because he'll write or he'll hit us up in the chat and be like, yeah, I have these 20 songs written and stuff like that. And I know he's got material that didn't even make it onto this last album. That's cool to have all those ideas to pick from.
Yeah, I'm excited to whenever we can go back and record some more. Fun.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because when there's bands that aren't really on the same page, it'll be hard to even come together and like record five songs, but like, I'm looking, I think on this album, I think it's 15 songs or 13. Am I wrong? 15, right?
That sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, dude, that's good. Like, you know what I'm saying? Especially like, if it's like, yo, okay, we're coming out with an album, if there's 15 songs just like slated to me, that says that, all you guys were like super, super stoked on the whole process, and like actually, wanted to get it together, versus, treating it like it was like a drag or something.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I think it kind of kept this sane during this whole like quarantine thing,
Yeah.
like something to focus on besides there was so much negativity last year, you know.
You said that it was like a week before the shutdowns happened when you guys started recording. So eventually you guys went back to the studio when, after a couple months, or was it just, you know, as much like file sharing, or just like, were you guys always getting COVID tested and making sure you guys are good, or how did that work out?
Well, the studio is like enormous, and you know, it's not like we're all recording at the same time. So like, you know, like the guitar player would go, or like, you know, a couple of the horn players would go. I don't think we were all there at the same time at any point.
Yeah, it was all a bunch of smaller groups. I don't know when we started going back, because I came in kind of late in the process after all the rhythm section was laid down.
It was like maybe a month or two later, because like no one knew what was going on, you know?
Yeah.
Mostly we were about to leave for tour, and we had to, we were going to do a run with Flying Raccoon Suit, actually, in Mephistopheles. And,
yeah, I was looking forward to that, because I've been trying to, well, I think Duck and I have both been trying to make that happen for a while, and it finally, the stars aligned, and then it got shut down.
Oh, that's going to be so fun, too, man.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, obviously, I'm outside of the circle, so I can't really say it, but I mean, there's nothing to say that, you know, you guys can't do it, you know, once everything opens back up. Hopefully. You know? Absolutely. Yeah.
A good note to how much better like Joystick has been in the past few years. Like Doug said, I remember one of my, maybe the first ska show I ever went to was Joystick before I was in the band. And I do remember Doug saying on stage, like, we haven't practiced at all this year. And then they went on to kill a set and just like do incredible.
I don't remember.
Hell yeah. Damn. Hell yeah. Nah, hey, you know, whenever you guys do that, you know, Flying Raccoon Suit and Joystick run, make sure you guys come over here for sure. Cause that's,
oh, I'd love that. Sounds awesome.
Go back.
Have you guys ever like tried as Joystick, like starting your own label or, you know, things like that? Or has it always just been collabing with other people?
I mean, I had my own label back in like the late 90s. Early 2000s, I released a 7-inch and a couple CDs and stuff, and it was just bad timing, and I ended up losing a lot of money. It was like right towards the end of like everything was switching to digital, and so CDs and like all that stuff, like no one was buying vinyl back then, so I lost a lot of money. And so I just, after that, it's also a lot of work, you know. And I don't, like Mike from that time, I have no idea how he's in a band full time and running a label. Like, I don't know how he does that. That it's insane.
Yeah, huge respect to people that can do that. I mean, trying to self-release an album, if you're going to go that route and try to, you know, ship out hundreds of records and market it and do all this other stuff is a huge pain. So
yeah,
Mike is awesome.
I don't think I'm that organized. My brain, I can do like one thing at a time.
Was there ever a time where other labels that, you know, aside from Stomp that were trying to like work with you guys and for some odd reason, it just didn't come together?
Not that I know of, but we didn't really like try or care, you know. I mean, we kind of like for the first like what, like 5 years we were a band, 6 years we were a band, we kind of were just like, yeah, you know, hey, fuck it, whatever, let's just do what's fun, you know. You know, and kind of just whatever. And it wasn't until like, you know, later on that we started like putting more effort into it, you know.
Yeah.
By that point, we were already on Stomp. And so after they released the first album, they were already like saying how they wanted to do our next album with them again. So we already basically had that lined up, you know.
Yeah, hey, that's actually dope as hell, because, you know, that means that they're actually, you know, there for the relationship, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
I was going to say, you know, one thing I was curious about to try and get your guys' take on it was Joystick, technically, as you guys were talking about earlier, has been around since 2009. you know, and you guys are still going strong today. So over the years, like the ska scene has kind of, you know, kind of like changed in like ways, you know, like different ways. Like if I think back to 09, 2010, like that was like the Facebook era, I guess you could say,
yeah.
You know, the Facebook event page era. And then, you know, now I guess you could call it what, like the Instagram TikTok era.
Pretty much, yeah. It's that there was a period in New Orleans where Joystick was probably the only ska band, and now we're up to at least three. That's good.
When Joystick first started, we actually had a MySpace page, and I actually pulled it up about a month ago, and it's still up there. Oh boy.
Is that music player still there, or is it different now?
No, but the pictures are, and man, wow. I think I was 28 or 29 back then, and like Clay and Mickey were like 17, like 18. They were, it was like, wow, what was going on? It's crazy, man, how much we've changed in the last 12 years, but not changed. I mean, it was, there was like a big change like earlier on when social media first started, but that was like before Joystick. If I understand your question correctly,
we haven't done a lot of Twitter, but luckily Instagram still has a much better reach than Facebook, and we haven't really done TikTok either, which has been big for some bands. Like I've seen Bad Operation and Scott's Team Network and stuff like that use it to pretty good success, but I feel super awkward on there, so haven't quite figured that out yet.
Yeah, I don't know how any of that works.
And I honestly feel the same way you do whenever I'm on there. I'm always just kind of like, what I notice is like what works on TikTok is like selfie videos, you know?
Oh, yeah. I feel so awkward doing that, but it does work. And I mean, Instagram, that's the thing too. You can't, there's all these algorithm like tricks you have to avoid. Don't use pictures with text in them. Don't post videos. You have to use this cascade feature. So like Instagram really wants you to use the selfies and stuff too. So I'm trying to get better at that, but I still feel self-conscious.
It's funny to me because the ska community is it's small as compared to, you know, people outside of it, and then you know, in it feels like big, you know what I'm saying? Like me, I feel like, yo, there's people all over, like, you know, the world that listen to ska, and you know, it's huge. But like to people that really just don't know ska like that.
Yeah, I've had to, I mean, I know Duck has had this too, but I've had to describe what ska is to tons of people.
Yeah. Recently, when I was showing someone an example of a ska band, they're like, oh, hey, this sounds like running music. I was like, yeah, I guess you could say that. One way to describe
that's
it.
Fair.
Yeah, I was like, you know, that's definitely one way to describe it for sure. You know?
Yep.
I'm hoping shows come back soon. You know, I really appreciate you sending that album to me, man.
Yeah, no problem, man. Thanks for listening to it. There's, I think, four variants, and like Stomp is getting some, and Bad Time is getting some, and then Pook Out is doing some distro in Europe and the UK, and Punk Mart is getting some for Japan.
Nice.
So yeah, they're kind of just going everywhere, but it's exciting. And then the album comes out April 16th.
It'll be good to blast everybody with something right away.
Pre-order's already up for the variants, or is that?
It'll be up tomorrow on 311. Why 311, right?
Yeah. I think by the time this is up, yeah, it'll be available for pre-order.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
I appreciate you guys, you know, for making the time. I just, you know, before we go, I just want to know if there's anything else we could plug, you know, coming up with Joystick, you know, before we get out of here.
Just the album we got. There's like a bundle with some shirts. We have like a new shirt design. It's pretty dope. And yeah, that's it. Because there's no touring.
As someone that, you know, got to listen to the album early, there's a lot of cool moments, you know, especially in I think it's the song with the piano. I think it was called Semicolon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who's playing piano on the intro?
Our friend Alex is.
Okay. Yeah.
He's he has a piano in the back of a pickup truck that he drives around, and he'll park in places and just play piano for people. he's super talented. So we just went over there and he just wrote that on the fly. I think it was like his second or third take, and he just like, yeah, he killed it.